If I were to ask you what games like Turbo Outrun, Hang On, Pole Position, and Rad Racer had in common, what would be the answer? They all involve passing checkpoints and avoiding obstacles as you race to the finish line before time runs out. However, there's another thing these games have in common. Dense traffic. While not too terrible in the long run, it sure does make the experience a lot harder than it ought to be. The other vehicles bounce you around like a pinball, or in the case of Pole Position, they blow you up. Don't you wish you could show the traffic who's boss? Well, there is such a game that lets you do that. RoadBlasters, released in 1987 by Atari Games, not to be confused with RoadBlaster, also called Road Avenger, a QuickTime event game. RoadBlasters was ported to many home systems like the Commodore 64 and Sega Genesis. The NES version developed by Beam Software is what we'll see in this episode. Does it live up to the arcade version? Let's find out. Once you start the game, a stage selection screen appears. What's wonderful about this particular one is its bookmark style. If you've gotten far in the game, you can skip ahead to different chapters as opposed to other games from this era always requiring a full game playthrough unless the game has a level select code or a warp zone. For instance, if you played the first three levels in RoadBlasters, you can select level 4 and continue from there. Although if you complete part of a section, like stages 11 through 14, and quit playing mid-game, you have to repeat stage 11 once you return to it. The same goes for the other chapters. This was the norm for the early age of video games, after all. The goal of RoadBlasters is simple. Race to the finish line while shooting enemies that come in view. You also have to keep an eye on your fuel gauges. You refuel the main tank by obtaining two different spheres. The green ones are encountered at certain points of a level, and they fill the tank only a little. The orange spheres are gotten by eliminating foes, and they offer more fuel than the green ones, but they move forward, nearly matching your speed. Once you complete half a stage, which the game calls a rally, the main tank will considerably increase. That said, the game is generous with its time limit. The problem I have with games like Hang On is that they mostly require memorization over skill. Wiping out has serious consequences. Not only does it take a while to recover, but the clock keeps ticking down and you're given little time to reach each checkpoint. Plus, sharp corners, congested traffic, and hills can be common and sometimes sudden, so lightning-fast reflexes and quick thinking hardly help, especially when a vehicle shoves you tremendously to the side with no hope of dodging stationary objects unless you're lucky. The fact that a crash-free run is needed for success in some of those games is ludicrous. Exploding is hardly a repercussion in NES RoadBlasters. The sprites disappear upon your demise, and the gas only resumes draining as soon as you reappear. The only major thing to worry about is missing the chances to grab fuel globes or a secondary weapon after blowing up. The turns are also very easy to make. That way, you can concentrate on killing enemies while navigating the corners. You can also slow down, but you almost never need to. In addition, the viewpoint is diagonally above the highway instead of behind the car or directly overhead, and the terrain is always flat, so you usually know well in advance what's coming up. The car controls are as follows. You accelerate using up on the D-pad, steer with left and right, and decelerate by pushing down. The A button fires the standard guns, and the B button uses the secondary item. The acceleration in this game is unlike most other games. The car will keep moving forward even after you stop pushing up, so you don't have to worry about holding up the entire time. The maximum speed is 212 in kilometers per hour, I think. Your primary weapon has infinite ammo. It gets the job done quite well since every foe only takes one shot to kill. Every so often, an aircraft descends and drops an additional pickup. There are four to get: an Uzi cannon, cruise missiles, nitro injectors, and an electro shield. The Uzi cannon is the standard machine gun. The cruise missiles are basically smart bombs, obliterating every obstacle on the screen. But they also annihilate green gas orbs. Nitro injectors increase your speed significantly for a short while. Finally, the electro shield acts as both a weapon and a barrier, rendering you temporarily invulnerable and destroying enemies at the same time. I will now discuss the roster of enemies. The orange-brown cars are the usual vehicles you'll face. They're the easiest to destroy. The purplish-blue cars are indestructible unless you have an electro shield or cruise missiles. Bikers are the same as the orange-brown cars, only they're harder to shoot. The rat jeeps come from behind and try to ram you. Roadside turrets can be a problem thanks to their bullets, especially during a turn because their trajectory tracks your movement. In the later rallies, some vehicles except the rat jeeps change lanes constantly. So it kind of becomes a gamble. Do you avoid them or shoot them? You'll also encounter landmines and oil spills. Oil spills do what you'd expect, make you momentarily lose control. Right before you reach a group of mines, an alarm will sound and a light next to the reserve tank will flash. I really love this, since it's not too common in 80s action games that the player is warned of an approaching danger. The only hazard that didn't make it into this port was the spiker. The mine alarm isn't the only alert you'll get. When your main gas gauge is empty, the reserve kicks in. As it does, a low-pitched tone sounds off. The way you refill the reserve tank is rather unique. When you defeat an adversary with your primary weapon, the score multiplier increases one digit. If you miss, it drops a digit. It'll stop going up when it reaches 10. The higher the count, the more fuel is added to the reserve tank after reaching a level's end. Missing a target with the Uzi cannon or the electro shield has no effect on the multiplier. With that in mind, don't get trigger happy with the main guns. So, is there anything wrong with NES Road Blasters? Honestly, not much. The only thing that bugs me is that the crosswalk indicating the course's halfway point wasn't incorporated into the game. Other than that, Beam Software created a faithful and more fair port of one of Atari's classics. I say fair because the Sega Genesis Edition, a 95% accurate port of the arcade, is just as much a trial and error game as OutRun or Rad Racer. Obstacles close the distance so fast, giving you only a nanosecond to react, and sometimes you can't see most of the road. More often than not, you blow up. The speed in the NES port is slower, therefore granting a bigger chance at dodging the hazards, and you can see most of the road. The audio, graphics, and gameplay get the job done. Most things don't sound annoying, the designs don't look out of place, and the game as a whole is plain wonderful. Just keep in mind that strategy and good reflexes matter in a game like this. In conclusion, Road Blasters for the NES is an excellent title to add to your gaming library.